Welcome back to the WDSU News Hot Seat. Tonight's topic, reaction to the latest development and the challenge by locals who are appealing their rejection by the RSD and State Board of Education to operate charter schools here in the Metro New Orleans area. Here's a voice from the protest rally at Landry High School Thursday night. Again, our guests from the New Orleans East Charter Academy Board, Dr. Calvin Mackey, Dr. Norm Whitley, and Jacob Cohen. Let's start with you, Mr. Cohen, this time. Why the disconnect? You guys out at the New Orleans East Charter Board have been trying to get a charter for quite some time, unsuccessfully. Why the disconnect when it comes to charter schools, local people running it?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think, you know, one of the tragedies there is that a local group like NOECA, I mean, we're really trying to pioneer school transformation, but also it really encouraging community ownership. When we look at the students and the parents who have been disserved by the RSD at this school for 5 years, we see them as the experts. We see them as the visionaries. We're partnering with parents and students to lift their vision for the school and to transform it in an inclusive way. So when a group like Bessie and NAXA denies a charter application from a group like NOECA, they're actually disempowering students, parents, and communities who have been working for several years to articulate their own vision for transforming their school. And they're disempowering the very people who understand what needs to happen to make these schools change. And I think we're seeing that all over the city right now with local community groups who are attempting to bring democracy back to New Orleans education reform and are getting the doors slammed in our faces.
But the powers that be who make the decisions about who gets a charter are saying that you guys don't measure up, Dr. Whitley.
That's correct. And I'm not sitting here claiming that our application was perfect and our organization was perfect in any way. But I think what is fair to say is that the process that exists now is not on an even playing field, in the sense that it requires a board like ours, who is going to create an application, to spend a lot of time, a lot of effort, okay, and use resources that basically we don't have access to. It's much easier if you are a professional organization, a charter management organization, where you have assets that you can tap into, whether that be assets of previous applications, previous successes, or even a staff just to write applications, or to hire people part-time, to bring in a chief academic officer and say, I want you to come in here and sit with us while we write this charter. We don't have those kinds of assets. There's no community group in the city of New Orleans that has that kind of asset up front. Our only alternative to get those sorts of assets is to borrow money. And we're not going to do that on basically what is a bet, whether or not we actually get the charter application approved or not. I think that's unreasonable for me as president of the board to say, I'm going to put my board in that kind of risk.
In that case, Dr. Mackey, how do you compete?
Well, and that was the point I was about to bring up. I mean, I never forget an old gentleman in a neighborhood where I lived that used to play dice all the time. And every time I would try to grab the dice, he said, don't touch them, son. Those dice are loaded. The dice are loaded in a charter application, and they're loaded towards the charter management organizations that's already in place. So some of these people have been seeded with millions of dollars to plan and millions of dollars to get their CMO, their charter maintenance organization, in place to run schools. And we have a community group that's coming together doing hard work, and then we are compared to them who are getting millions of dollars from federal government grants to plan. And then one of the knocks against us is that, well, you all don't have $1 million. Well, you all gave them $1 million. Seemed like to me the pieces that are in place and the money that's in place for people to plan for their charter management organization should go to community groups who otherwise really need the year, instead of going to a group that's already been in place, already running charter schools, so they can plan another charter school. So if you're asking me how can we compete, one way we can compete is that they could create a mentoring process. I mean, they could put something in place where the NASCA could take us under their wing and explain their process to us, take us through their process. There's nothing like that. It's like you show up to play baseball, and these people have been playing baseball for 20 years, and you're just learning the game.
When it comes to education, though, why does it matter whether the group that runs a particular school is local or not? Dr. Whitley.
My belief is, and I think there's good evidence of this, that long-term success of these schools depends on community ownership. And right now that there's nothing about this process that's worried about long-term success. It's all worried about short-term gains. So if you look at the way that they award charter approvals in the state of Louisiana, it's based on past experience of success, much of that in the state of Louisiana. So there's not a lot of history here. So you're basically awarding new charters based on a very short history. And it worries me that you can predict so much of the future based on a very short history of success. I don't think that's true. I think, in fact, a lot of these schools have had short-term gains because they've been able to capture low-hanging fruit. They've been able to make changes. They're enthusiastic. They've changed processes. Don't get me wrong. It's not clear to me that success is sustainable in any way, okay, going 5 years from now. Community ownership, I think, is the key, because then people and parents, and especially parents, are involved in the success of that school.
Mr. Cohen? I think,
you know, there were a lot of tremendously powerful and talented people that came to New Orleans after Hurricane Katrina. There's been an influx of human capital, and we've seen some improvements in New Orleans schools. But back to this question of sustainability, we need to begin to develop the local capacity, the local leadership, and the local ownership, because we really don't know at this point how long these people who came to New Orleans after Hurricane Katrina are going to stay here. And if we don't begin to build that bottom-up capacity, over the long haul, we could be in serious trouble.
I've heard it said that if you want to know what's the driving force behind the charge to get charter schools, is follow the money. Aren't you guys interested in money as well?
Well, it's definitely follow the money. I mean, there's three things here at place. You asked a question about why it's important for local people to control their schools. Because one, that is what was sold to us. We told us this whole thing was about choice and about community ownership of schools. And when they told us it was about choice, we didn't know that they was talking about whether or not they chose us. And that's what it's turned out to. In terms of the money, there's money that comes with each kid. We're not a for-profit organization. There are for-profit management organizations down here running schools. What we want to do is create a situation and create an environment where a kid can get the best education they can and pour all of the dollars that's generated from our schools back into the schools.
So you can categorically deny that money is a factor, and when it comes to your desire to operate a charter school?
Absolutely. None of us make any salary, and we only planned on having an organizational management team basically to run the school, and that was it.
So, but there is a money in this model that's being put in place in New Orleans is a free market-based model. So money is definitely in play in terms of the model that's being put in place in New Orleans. Our organization, NOECA, is a nonprofit management organization that would oversee the operation of the school, but they are for-profit entities here that are doing quite well. And there are many for-profit technology companies and other companies that have their hand in this.
All right, well, I'll tell you, you get the last word.
Sure, I just think there's one other story here about educational access in New Orleans East. In the last month, we've heard that Abramson is going to be shuttered. Mm-hmm. We've heard Sarah T. Reed is going to be phased out, beginning with the ninth grade, really removing two of the three public co-ed educational options for the New Orleans East community. And if they're really about choice, they need to allow parents to value their proximity to education. And if parents choose that they want a school in New Orleans East, they ought to have some quality options there.
All right, well, we'll get John White in here next Sunday, and we'll find out what he has to say about all this. Gentlemen, thank you very much. That's all the time we have. Thanks to my guest, and thanks to you, as always, for watching. Now let's head back over to the news desk.